Thank you for joining us on What Will Happen in Karnataka. Today we are speaking to Sugata Srinivasaraju about Bellary and the Reddy brothers, who were instrumental in bringing BJP to its first victory in 2008 before receding from politics after the indictment in the mining scams. Hi Sugata.
Hi Nidhi.
So can you tell us more about Bellary and the Reddy brothers and why Bellary is at the center of all political discussion at the moment?
Yeah, before I answer your question, Nidhi, let me just offer a small clarification. The Reddy brothers have not yet been indicted. There are a lot of cases running in various courts and they are still defending themselves. And yes, Janardhan Reddy was in jail. He's out on bail and he's not supposed to enter Bellary at all. So that's the kind of restriction with which he's functioning in Karnataka at this point of time. And now coming back to the question that you asked me, why are the Reddy brothers at the center of all discussions in Karnataka? The answer is quite simple. They have been given tickets. That is, two of the Reddy brothers have been given tickets. And that's a well-known fact by now. And one of Reddy's very close associates has been given a ticket. That is Sri Ramalu. He's not just contesting from one seat, he's contesting from two seats, and he's taking on Chief Minister Siddaramaiah in a seat called Badami in North Karnataka. That's in Bagalkot district. Besides these three people, there are three other affiliates of these people who have been given tickets. So one has been given a ticket in Bangalore and two others in the same region, in the Bellary region. So obviously, you know, I mean, people who have been discussed so much, who have been national and international news in the last decade or so, making their way back into the BJP has shocked a lot of people who have been watching the BJP. It's not just people who are opponents or who are in the opposition or who are in the Congress or in the Janata Dal or in any other party who have been shocked by the ease with which these people have got back into the mainstream. It's people within the BJP themselves who are really surprised as to how these people have made a comeback. So this shock that is there about these people coming back into mainstream politics is something that has propelled a discussion about these people. So that's primarily why they're being discussed.
Why has BJP retained the Reddy brothers despite their involvement in the scams?
That's a million-dollar question which is not being answered. See, we don't have an answer for that from people like Amit Shah. We don't have an answer for that from someone like the Prime Minister, who speaks so much about corruption and who has also been attacking Chief Minister Siddaramaiah for alleged corrupt deals and stuff like that. But we don't have answer from the top BJP leaders as to why these people have been allowed to come in. The only time Amit Shah tried to speak about the Reddy brothers, he said the BJP has got nothing to do with the Reddy brothers. But then the next thing that we see happening is Janardhan Reddy, is the prime accused in the Bellary mining scam, is seen campaigning in Molkalmuru because he can't campaign in Bellary, he can't enter Bellary. He's seen campaigning for his friend, Jigar Ka Dost, as they say, Sri Ramalu, in that place, and he's caught on camera doing that. And then you discover BJP leaflets in which his tour program has been printed. And then you get someone like Yediyurappa, who was very, very annoyed and troubled and all that by these Reddy brothers when he was in power between 2008 and 2011, saying that the Reddys coming back to the BJP has given me the strength of 10 elephants. So that was a funny thing to sort of say, because the scam, that the proportion of the scam that the Reddy brothers have perpetrated allegedly is something which should put everybody to shame. So, and despite that, I don't know what compels someone like Yediyurappa to say that these people give the BJP and give him personally the strength of many, many elephants. So I mean, he put that, that's an idiomatic use in Kannada. So he said hattu ane bala. So that is a that's a surprising thing coming from Yediyurappa, because he's been tormented by these people when he was in power. And I mean, it really surprises somebody who's been watching the BJP, watching the way they lost power in 2013, and they going back to embrace the Reddy brothers. You know, I mean, you know, what will happen is that they may, you know, the simple explanation is that the Reddy brothers may help the BJP win, say, 3 or 4, 5, 6 seats in that region, the Bellary region, or the fringes of Davangere district, or parts of Chitradurga. So, you know, the trick is not Reddy brothers. The liability, Reddy brothers are a liability, but Sriramulu, who is a very, very close friend of the Reddy brothers, is someone who has political weight or commands a lot of political currency, because he is from a community called the Valmiki community or the Nayak community. And Valmikis or Nayaks in Karnataka are a scheduled tribe community, and they have a very strong presence in those areas. Demographically, they are pretty important for any party which contests an election from that part of the state. So they may help the BJP win a few seats. That may be a kind of calculation that these people have made. But if they have to win those seats with the help of Reddy brothers, it also explains the desperation of the BJP. If the BJP is using the Reddy brothers to win these seats, then it speaks a great deal about the BJP's electoral strength during these elections. It speaks about their desperation. So they may be deploying these people for the demographic strength that they have, caste strengths that they have, because of Sriramulu or because of the money power that they have. But by doing that, the larger narrative that they could have built is lost completely. I think they've also angered the urban voters as a result of this, because corruption is a bit of an issue among literate, educated urban voters. And Reddy brothers are an epitome of big corruption in Karnataka, not just in Karnataka, across India. So this, I'm really not sure what the strategy is. You know, you using this phrase may probably explain things better, which is they may be, I think they are probably penny wise and pound foolish when it comes to this. So the Prime Minister now can't speak about corruption. Amit Shah can't speak about corruption. Even if there is a big issue that they wanted to raise during these elections, Chief Minister Siddaramaiah also has sort of made them very conscious of the fact that Yediyurappa himself was accused of corruption and was in jail and spent a small term in jail. So now with that kind of an attack on Yediyurappa, who's a chief ministerial candidate, and then over and above that you bring the Reddy brothers back. I mean, it's inexplicable. It's a conundrum which one is not in a position to explain. There must be some kind of great strategic thing which we don't understand, perhaps, which the BJP has.
Do you think the Congress government has done enough to prosecute the Reddy brothers or to collect the penalties that they owe?
Oh, that's a very good question, Nidhi. It's a sad story. The 5 years that the Congress government has been in power, they've done very little to recover penalties. If the Congress government had done all that it had promised to do before the 2013 elections, that is to set up special courts, to have a very speedy trial, to send them to jail, all that rhetoric that one heard before 2013, is now, I think, you know, I mean, they just completely sat over it for 5 years. Interestingly, the Siddaramaiah government even set up a cabinet subcommittee to look into the whole illegal export of ore. And this committee, the primary document that all these people had was the Lokayukta report, which Justice Santosh Hegde had submitted. So when they started making an assessment They said that the Santosh Hegde report says that there was a loss of 3 crore tons. That was the kind of loss assessment that the Lokayukta report had done. But the cabinet subcommittee got additional information from the railway department and sourced other information which had not been collected and estimated the loss to be much higher. But the HK Patil subcommittee, cabinet subcommittee, pegged it at 35 crore tons. And if 1 ton of ore was being sold at 4,000 rupees, you know, that's the figure that you find in Justice Santosh Hegde's report, then the loss is an amazing 1 lakh crore. So that's the loss estimate that one could make. So this was the kind of huge loss that the state had incurred. If you just went by the Santosh Hegde report, it was 12,000 crore odd loss to the exchequer. But if you went by the HK Patil committees, that is the cabinet subcommittee report, the loss was close to 1 lakh crore. But there's another arithmetic about the mine ore and loss to the exchequer. See, that would peg the loss at around 11 lakh crore. You know how? Because Santosh Hegde, Justice Santosh Hegde in his report, recommends that a penalty 5 times of the loss should be collected. So if you just do a simple arithmetic of all the companies which have caused this loss, and all those companies are listed in the Supreme Court's CEC report, which is all the C category companies. I mean, the Supreme Court categorized companies which were involved in mining and the extent of their illegality and put them under 3 different categories. So if you just look at the C category companies which had done the most damage, and if you just calculate the illegal export that these companies had done, and if you calculate it at the level of 6,000 rupees per metric ton, then the loss that, and multiplied by 5 times as he has recommended, then the loss to the exchequer would be around 11 lakh crore. But even if it's 1 lakh crore as HK Patil committee has suggested, it's the budget of Karnataka for 1 year. 11 lakh crores is not a presumptive figure like it was in the 2G case. This is actually based on the recommendation that a Lokayukta has made. So this is not an imaginary figure. This figure could well be real. It's important to say this because the Chief Minister has been tweeting of late, and he has been saying that the loss to the exchequer was 35,000 crores. So it's important to tell him that it's not just 35,000 crores, it's much more than that.
Has Prime Minister Narendra Modi spoken about this in the rallies that he's been addressing?
Not until this date, Nidhi. I hope he addresses this whole big question, because Modi has not just addressed this question, which is a very, very important thing in top on the mind of everybody in Karnataka at this point of time, that how is it that the Reddy brothers have entered the BJP through the back door. But Modi has also not spoken about Mahdai, or a river dispute which is so very central to many districts in North Karnataka. Modi has not spoken about the creation of a board for Kaveri river water sharing. Modi has not spoken about Yedurappa's corruption. Modi has not spoken about a host of issues. I think it's very convenient for him to sort of just brush these things aside and speak what just he thinks he should communicate. I think that's a way of just trying to build a new narrative each time he comes here. I hope he addresses, he's going to be addressing a lot of rallies from now on until the elections on the 12th of May. And I really hope that he addresses a lot of these.
Yeah. Thank you, Sugata.
Thank you, Nidhi.
Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you again on the next episode of What Will Happen in Karnataka.